Praise the Lord. It's wonderful to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Wonderful to see all your faces. We welcome you in this place, Lord. You are the King of Kings, the great I Am, the mighty God. Lord, we just worship and adore you. And Lord, we give this service over to you. As we go into this service, we just ask that you move in a mighty and a powerful way. Let your sweet Holy Spirit fill this place to overflowing, Lord. Let it reach the neighbors, that they would feel your draw and that they would come unto you. Lord, we just worship and adore you. We give everything in this service to your hands. Let every spoken word be anointed of you and your word coming forth, and let every song be anointed that lives would be changed. We want an encounter with you tonight, Lord, a life-changing encounter with you. We give you all the praise. We give you all the glory in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Before we go into the music, the family of Ryan Goodson gave a thank you card, and I wanted to read it to the body. Thank you sincerely for sharing our sorrow. Your kindness is deeply appreciated and will always be remembered by the family of Ryan Goodson. May God bless you, love and prayers. And I want to say that I was truly touched by all the outpouring of love from not just Free Indeed Ministries, but from the body of Christ all around. It was truly touching to see all the love of Christ through this hard time.
Amen.
And we're continuing to see it, and that's so encouraging. At this time, I want to turn it over to some of my favorite singers. Samantha tells me I'm a liar when I say that, but she's amazing.
Yeah.
Everywhere I
How many of you agree that that's some of the best singing you've ever heard? There are also such wonderful people, they declined a love offering. But I did learn today that there's a desire for them to go into a recording studio and do a CD. And I am going to pass a plate to get them started on that. And anybody that would like to hear a CD of them, please contribute to help them get started towards recording a CD. Isaac, will you come up and pass the plate?
Yeah.
Kyle, will you say a prayer over it?
Just a second, Isaac.
Perfect. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, Father, for this evening, Father, that you gave us, Lord.
Yes.
Father, we pray as we go through the remainder of this service, Father, that you would bless it, Lord. And Father, just lead, guide, and direct everything that's said and done. And Father, we pray for this offering, Father, to take it up, Lord. We pray, God, that you bless it and make it possible for them to make it easy, Father. We pray, God, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Derek, would you come up and give your testimony?
a lot of times, well, I don't need this microphone, I'm pretty loud. But I mean, I just want to start by saying, like, you know, when I was young, I had four brothers, and we were pretty wild kids. And, you know, as we grew up, you know, the people in our lives that we looked up to were criminals, you know. They were getting high, smoking cigarettes. And, you know, and that's where it started out for me. Like, you know, people were saying, hit this cigarette, it makes you feel good. And I did. And I started smoking when I was just a little kid, probably 7 or 8 years old, experimenting. I remember my brothers used to say, you're not inhaling, you're not inhaling. And then it was, I started smoking weed. People said, man, you got to try this. So I did. You know, I got that kind of buzz. And it just elevated from there, you know. That criminal lifestyle was attractive to me. I wanted to be part of it. And, you know, nobody around me was preaching about God. You know, nobody in my life was. Nobody was saying, like, hey, Derek, like, if you want to feel good, man, a good day's work will do it for you. You know, and it just elevated through, and, you know, and I started smoking crack. I smoked crack for the first time when I was 15 years old. Man, I'll never forget it. It changed my life. Like then I escalated to heroin. I got hooked on heroin, and it just destroyed my life. Took everything. What little I did have, I mean, I lost my job, I lost my family, I lost my freedom, I lost everything. I mean, it took everything from me. You know, when I was out there on the run, I was on the run from three different counties at one time, and I was just scared for my life. Still trying to keep that buzz going. Like, that's the only thing I cared about was just getting high. That's it. That was my everyday life. All I cared about was where that next buzz was going to come from. And whoever I had to step on or push down to get it, I would do it. I didn't care. And like I said, it just destroyed my life. And I did about 11 years of my life incarcerated, but the last time I did 5 years, I went to prison for an armed robbery charge. And I got 7 years. I went up there, and my buddy was in a faith-based program called the PLUS program. In the prison, he was like, hey, Solly, come over here and get in this program with me. And I just did it for a time, but I didn't have no really want to change. I just wanted to get a time cut, so I got in the program for that reason alone. And as I was going through the program, I remember I had been telling my family, like, man, I'm changing, I'm in this program, I'm doing the right thing. I was just lying to them. Well, I'd been up for like 3 days doing ICE and doing Suboxone. And I just fell asleep, and they came up and woke me up and was like, hey, you gotta go to HSU. So I go down to HSU, and the security guard down there is like, hey, I don't even know what I'm going down there for. So I get down there, and he's like, hey, Solomon, I need you for your analysis. So I'm like, oh man, I'm in trouble. So I went in there and took the urine analysis, and then the results came up negative, so positive. So I said, nah, man, I haven't used them. The guard's name was Gordy, so I said, man, Gordy, I ain't been using it. He said, well, if you sign an admission of guilt right now, then you're just going to get a B write-up. But if you refuse it, then it's going to be an A write-up. And an A write-up's pretty serious. You lose time, and you get locked down for a lot of time. So I wouldn't do it. I said, no, I'm not dirty. I haven't used. He said, well, if it comes back that you have, he said, then you know you're going to lose your program and everything. So I went back to the dorm. I was worried to death. I was like, man, I'm going to get kicked out of this program. I'm going to get a time cut. Everybody's going to know I'm using. So I started praying. I was like, man, Lord, if you save me from this, I'm going to straighten up and do this program and do the right thing. And I didn't hear nothing for about a week about it. And then I went down to HSU because we had to do these hospice watches. That was part of the program. And I went down there, and Gordy came up to me and was like, hey, Solomon. He's like, you owe me when I threw that drug screen away. And I knew it was the Lord. I knew it was. And I made a commitment to him. So I said, you know what? I'm going to do this program. I'm going to do this program and take it serious and get this time cut. So I started doing that program. And I was working out with this guy. He was reading the Bible. And he was just playing scenes with me and telling me, like, hey, read this verse. And I don't know if you guys know this, but the Bible is like a guide for sobriety. me. It is. It has so many verses that are dear to my heart that I've memorized that really helped me on my way to sobriety. But I picked that Bible up and started reading it. And one of the first verses that I memorized is James 1:12. But it says, "Blessed is he who endures temptation. For when he is tried, he will receive the crown of life his Lord has promised to those who love him."
Amen.
And you know, that verse means a lot to me because, you know, like all the things I had lost because I was going through temptations in my life, and I was falling into them. I was giving into my temptations. Every little temptation, everything I wanted, everything my flesh wanted, I just gave into it and just gave it what it wanted, and it just kept taking and taking and taking from my life. And that's why that verse is so meaningful to me, because now that I've endured those temptations and I say, you know what, I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm not going to get high today. I'm not going to worry about winning today. I'm not going to worry about money today. I'm not going to worry about getting high today. You know, the Lord has restored and blessed things back to me that I've lost.
Amen.
Like my family, you know, my freedom. You know, my family is the most important thing to me. You know, my dad back here. And my wife, which I love with all my heart. My daughter, I love with all my heart. And my daughter, when she was young, she was like my best friend. Like, even though I was getting high, I still tried to make time with her through that. And man, she went through so much watching me in and out of her life. And just, you know, I don't know how much that affects her. But while I was in this faith-based program, you know, we did like spiritual literacy, purposeful driven life, 12 steps to Christ, goal setting, you know. And as I was reading the Bible and taking these programs seriously, you know, it's like the Lord just opened my eyes to what was going on around me, and I really started seeing prison for what it was, man. It was like just a bunch of kids, man, and all, you know, it's like they're blind, you know, and they're lost, just like I was lost. It's like the Lord just opened my eyes to it, and it started becoming where it was just so, like, it was so fake. Like, all people do sit around and lie and exaggerate all the time about. All they do is sit around all day long and plot on how we're going to get high. And all they do is talk about who they ripped off, who they whooped, how much dope they've done, what they're going to do when they get out. They're going to still do the same thing, or they're just going to do it smarter. And you know, that really started separating me from it. So that caused me to dig deeper into my Bible. And then I went from there. I started doing... I did RWI, which is also like a faith-based program while I was in prison, and I became a mentor in that program. And, you know, a lot of the people even in that program that weren't taking it serious, they were mentors, you know. People would come up to me and be like, "Man, Sully, I appreciate you because, you know, you're really walking what you're talking about." You know, people used to tell me all the time, like, "When you get out, you're going to get high, you're going to get high." And, you know, that really made me, that lit a fire in me too, you know, because I just wanted to prove to them that I wasn't going to. You know, and I still hadn't, like, really accepted God in my life. And I kept praying and praying that the Lord would soften my heart, because I really wasn't, like, feeling love the way that I should and accepting it the way that I should, and I still don't the way that I should, because when Satan's your ruler, you don't care about nobody. You lose the love for yourself. You lose love for everybody. You can't feel that love and receive it the way that you should. Maybe you don't. It seems fake. And people tell you that they love you. And you know, Satan's in your ear saying, "No, they don't." You know, they don't love you. You know? And so I started digging deeper in my Bible. Well, one night I went to church in prison. And I hit the altar and I hit my knees. And man, I just started crying. I cried for the first time in a long time. I mean, really felt the love, and I just called out to the Lord and said, "Lord, man, please save me from myself. You know, I need you in my life, Lord. I want you in my life." You know, when I accepted Jesus Christ into my heart, and I wanted him to be the ruler, and I wanted love to rule my life, and not evil, not pain, that really changed. The word really changed me, you know. And I think it's Hebrews chapter 12, but it says, "Submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, he will draw near to you. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up." Yeah. And I submitted to God, and I started resisting the devil, and really just started just being free, and I was happier in prison than I ever was on the streets when I was out there chasing the drugs and getting high and causing nothing but destruction and harm and pain to my family. And you know, that's why I always say that, you know, the young people that we're around, we have so much influence on our kids and we have so much influence on the people around us. And for years, I advocated for the devil, and now I want to advocate for the Lord. I
believe.
This year. so much. One, I've spent 14 years working in a prison as a prison guard, and 5 of those years I was over the plus door. I saw lives changed through that, and I saw those that faked it and wouldn't let themselves be changed. I saw them hauled out on stretchers because they got a hold of the drugs right there in the prison. Some I was able to pray with, some I was able to witness to even as an officer. But some I had the heartbreak of watching fall through the cracks. Then, it'll be 2 years ago, next month, I got the most heartbreaking call I believe I had ever had in my life, because I had had a brother that had been battling addiction his whole life, and he was only 50 years old, and I got the call that we had lost him to an overdose. So when I see God preaching and saving young men out of that, I get excited.
Amen.
It touches me. It moves me. And I want to say, Derek, I love you. I'm proud of you. Stay with God and He will do great things in your life.
Amen.
I see a mighty ministry in your future. Now before I get any more emotional and start bawling like a little baby girl, I'm going to let Josh come up and sing, testify whatever he's got on his heart.
Amen.
Feel down in my soul.
Sometimes I
stayed up here all night and tell you what the Lord's done for me. You know, I was raised in a Christian home. And like everybody else, you know, I got out in the world and was drinking and partying. And I didn't do any drugs, but I drank a lot of alcohol. And then I tried and tried to have children on my own. Did the fertility drugs and everything and wasn't able to conceive. But the Lord made a way for me to be a mommy of five beautiful children. And I can't thank Him enough for that. And then in 2016, I wasn't serving the Lord like I should. I wasn't raising my kids. You know, we would go to church on Easter or whatever. And, you know, then the Lord, May 2016, I had a massive blood clot in my lungs. And that's when I turned my life back over to the Lord. And I said, Lord, if you see me through this, I will serve you to the best of my ability and raise my children in a Christian home just like I was brought up in. So ever since then, I've been serving the Lord the best I can, trying to reach all five of my children are saved and go to church with me. Now that they're older, you know, sometimes they don't come as much, but I teach them, you know, He's the only way.
Yes.
You know, they're out in the schools and stuff around others. You know, I did my part. They're old enough to know right from wrong now. And then May of 2023, I was getting out of my van. Just got off work. My 81-year-old neighbor shot me in my back over a property line. It was a 9.5-hour standoff with the police. And then again, I didn't know, like I'm on blood thinners because of the blood clot I had. I was bleeding so bad, I stood the whole time holding my back. It was like a TV show. All these police come in with their big guns and shields and take me off my porch. And I'm standing there and it seemed like it took forever for the ambulance to get there. And I had all this stuff running through my mind. Lord, you know, I don't know what it hit internally. But I finally got in the ambulance and I heard them say, care flight's on standby. I thought, oh, Lord. So then all of a sudden, I started praying, and all of a sudden, I just had this peace come over me. And the Lord quoted or read the scripture to me, Romans 8:28. And it says, all things work together for the good of those that love God and called according to His purpose. I knew right then and there I was going to be okay. So, I mean, like I said, I could stand up here all day long, and my brother-in-law that just passed away, he told me afterwards, he said, sister, he said, I was mad at God. He said, I told him, he said, if there was something happened to you, I would quit on God. And he said, sister, then the Lord spoke to me, Romans 8:28. So the Lord spoke that verse to both of us. And we were just in like, wow, what the power of God can do.
This altar is open at any time. I don't care what's going on. If you need to talk to the Lord, it's open. There'll be somebody there to pray with you. I'm going to go into probably the most popular scripture ever. It's been on my heart so much, and I've heard several preach on it recently, but I'm going to be in John, the 3rd chapter. Most precious Lord, Heavenly Father, we come to you right now, Lord, and I just praise you and I thank you for the opportunity that you've given to use me for your word to come forth. God, I ask that you allow me to lay myself down and that you would allow your spirit to speak through me. God, I want you to have your way, and I ask that you would anoint each and every person listening and each and every person that hears this by internet, that they might receive what your word has.
Yes.
Lord, I just want lives to be changed. I don't want my name remembered. I want you remembered. Lord, I worship you. I adore you. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Amen.
I'm going to start in the first verse. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest, except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. I'm going to stop and talk about that for just a minute. When we're born in the flesh, one of two things happens. Either we grow or we die. When we're born in the Spirit, like he told Nicodemus, it's the same thing. When we're born in the Spirit, either we grow spiritually or we die. And I'm not talking about the body dying with this death. I'm talking about eternal separation from our God and Father. I'm talking about separation to where we have no fellowship with the Father. We either grow or we die. We all grow at different rates, and I know being born again does not mean we're going to be perfect instantly. Anybody in here can tell you that don't happen. But there is growth. And what I want us to look at tonight is are you seeing growth in your life? Since you've received Christ, have you seen growth? Since last year, have you seen growth? Since last month, have you seen growth? Since this morning, have you seen growth? Because if we quit growing, then we're separating ourselves from God. Every moment of our Christian walk should be digging into His Word, should be leaning into Him, praying, God, what can I do? What can I do to be closer to you? What can I do for growth? We need to continue to grow or we will die. And I'm not saying that if you have a bad day, you're not going to make it. That's not a God of love. I'm saying we need to continually strive for growth. When we are born, the natural procession is you grow. And you continue to grow in certain ways until the time that you die. We as Christians need to continue to grow until the time He calls us home. We need to continue to grow until the time that we see Him face to face and are made like Him. On growth, the word has several places. I'm going to read a couple of them to you. 2 Peter 3:18 says, But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be glory, both now and forever. Amen. We're commanded to grow. We're commanded to move forward, not to sit still. That's one problem I see in the church today, and I'm not talking about this body. I'm not talking about any specific body. I'm talking about the church as a whole. We have become lazy, and we have sit still, and we have grown stagnant. It is time for us to wake up as a church and get back to the growth that we need to be doing. We're walking in the last days. It is time to quit being, as Brother Aaron preached last week, a lazy Christian. It's time to move forward and to grow in Christ. If you've been born, why are you not growing? If you've been born spiritually, why are you not seeing growth in your spiritual life? Why are you not gaining knowledge of the Word? Why are you not growing closer to Him? Why are you not being easier to stay away from sin day after day after day? Every moment of your life, it should be easier to walk away from the temptations. Every moment of your day, growth should grow easier to walk away from temptations and to tell somebody that you know about Christ, to tell a stranger on the street about Christ. It's time for the growth. It's time for us to quit sitting back and waiting for the pastor to feed us milk. It's time for us to dig into the Word and grow and eat some meat of the Word on our own. It's time for us to move forward. Verse 7 goes on, "Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit." If you're born of the Spirit, there's going to be some motion to you. If you're born of the Spirit, there's going to be some move to you. You're going to blow around like the wind, and nobody's going to tell where you're coming to or coming from, because you're doing God's work. Every person in this room has something that God has set for you to accomplish. Every person in this room has a calling on their life. Something that God wants you to be doing, and that may just be witnessing to the person next door to you. It may be witnessing to the person on your job, but we're all called to evangelize and tell the world about Christ. We're all called to show the world what we have received. I loved hearing Pastor Aaron last week talk about lazy Christians and how dare you sit and be lazy. How dare we sit and not grow? Yes, you may make it into heaven because you've received Christ. Yes, you may make it into heaven. But is that all there is to it? No. There's so much more. We are to take everybody we can with. We are to be a light to this world. We are to move out and let the world see that there is a Christ on this earth, that there is a God that delivers from drugs. There is a God that saves from being shot in the back. There is a God that raises from the dead here on this earth. And we are that example. We are that example that He has put on this earth. We are to be Christ to this earth. Ephesians 4, 13 and 16 on growth. And I'm going to read it. Something I usually will not do, but this I want to read out of the NIV version. I love the wording of it. "Then we will no longer be infants." How many of us in the body of Christ are still infants? How many times do we look around and see those that profess to be Christians, even for years and years, are still infants? It's time for the church to grow. Infants are, "Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves, blown here and there by every wind of teaching, and by the cunning craftiness of people in their deceitful scheme. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of Him who is the head, that is Christ." There is growth. We are to become mature. If we stay infants, like it says, we'll be blown by every wind of doctrine. I hear so many false teachings out there these days. I hear people say it's okay to do whatever you want to do. I hear people say that as long as you say that sinner's prayer, that you're going to be okay. No, there has to be a heartfelt change. True salvation is a heartfelt change. It don't mean just because I come up to this altar and say, oh God, forgive me, I'm a sinner, that you're going to make it. That is not being born again. Being born again means you have changed. You've given your life over to Him. You're ready to grab a hold of and move forward and be the church He has called us to be. This is not where I thought I was going with this. But like Aaron said last week, we've become a lazy church. And I'm stepping on my own toes too. I think of the testimony Christina just gave when she got shot. And how I was so mad at that neighbor. I was so mad at that neighbor, I wanted him to die. But I was had to repent of that and show the love that Christ called me to show. I had to repent of that and realize that maybe had I not been the lazy Christian, maybe had I not been the infant Christian that this word's talking about, maybe I could have got up and said something to that neighbor that would have changed his course. Maybe if I had been the mature Christian that God called me to be, maybe, just maybe, that poor man wouldn't be spending the rest of his life in prison. Maybe he would be celebrating right here in this building with us. Everything we do in our lives has an effect on somebody. Every move we make, every decision we make has an effect on somebody. I talked about my brother that passed of an overdose. And yes, there was a couple times I tried to talk to him, but had I not been that lazy Christian, had I not been that infant, had I stood strong, could I have maybe reached him? If you stand strong, can you maybe reach that one that's on drugs? Can you maybe be the one to reach the next Derek? If you're not the baby infant Christian, it's time for us to grow, church. It's time for us to move forward. It's time for us to put away the childish things. Lord, I just praise you and I worship you. God, I don't even know where to go from here. Just lead me and guide me. Speak through me, Lord. Have your way. I think I'm going to start wrapping this up. But I do want to skip down and read the 16th verse. I guarantee everyone in this room can quote this verse. Probably even the youngest ones in here can quote this verse. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now that I've spoke so directly to the body of Christ, there's several in here I don't know. I don't know what the condition of your soul is in. But there's several that I don't know. Jess, Samantha, would you come? There's a lot of faces I've not seen before. If you have not received, if you have not experienced that spiritual birth, please don't wait. If you've not experienced what Brother Derek experienced while he was in that prison, if you've not experienced what I experienced the night my mama texted me, the simple text, church starts at 7, to where I didn't make it to the bar, please don't wait. None of us are promised tomorrow. I think of my brother-in-law, and I thank God that I know for a fact where he's at. I think of Ryan and how he had plans. We had a revival, was planning a revival together. We had things that he and I was going to do together, and I know there's many others in this room that he had plans with. You're not promised tomorrow. If you've not experienced that, please come. There's many here that will pray with you. If you have experienced it and you've grown cold, if you have experienced it but you've grown cold and you've let yourself drift, please come renew. He wants that relationship with you.
Never make it.